Okay, guys, so there's a movie that I have been championing for months now on the channel, specifically in two separate videos, although we've never done a specific review of it, which is what we're finally here to do. But, guys, what did you think of One Cut of the Dead?
Wah, 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 wah!
Beautiful.
That's the only movie I've seen in a while.
Hey everyone, welcome to the Horror Show. I'm Cecil Laird.
I mean, Fuego here.
Rare producer Dave.
Exactly, yes, rare producer Dave. Camera appearance here, but it makes sense to have him on here.
If
yeah,
producer Dave shows up.
Indeed, indeed.
He's excited.
So here's the thing, guys. I talked about this movie in a couple of different videos on the channel, but never did an official review for it. I talked about the overall goodness of it, but we're gonna finally do a full review because I got two other parts of the show to watch it, and two people that I think would specifically appreciate it the most out of everyone on the show. And
especially so, because we got to see it in the theater.
Indeed.
I think that was an added benefit to the whole experience
and
for
an
me.
Audience situation, man.
Indeed. So this is another review straight out of the 2019 Phoenix Film Festival and International Horror and Sci-Fi Film Festival. This one is specifically one that Monty wanted to bring to the masses in a bigger capacity. And
before it hits Shudder, where everyone can see it finally.
Indeed, indeed. But I'm so glad that he did. So you guys know my overall thoughts. I thought One Cut of the Dead was the best horror movie of 2018 that most people weren't able to watch. So your guys' overall thoughts. Let me get your opinion. So Fuego, why don't you go first?
Okay, so with all the hype, this was one that could have been burdened with expectation, mm-hmm. you know, and all of that different stuff. And I must admit, for the first 20 minutes or so, I was like, okay, what's all the hoopla about? What is going on? This is okay enough, you know, but nothing that's wowing me significantly. And then, which the change happens that everybody has talked about, and you basically go behind the scenes of the creation of this film, and I fell utterly in love with the process, with the characters, with the passion, and honestly with the ambition of what they were trying to do on such a low budget and live on TV and everything. And the title actually refers to the fact that they're going to do just one cut, you know, mm-hmm. one take and just move the camera around. Dave, I know you've been, you know, part of, you know, filmmaking process numerous times, and so you probably have a little bit more insight to impart than I do, but dude, I love this movie. What about you?
Well, as a filmmaker, as a YouTube guy, whatever you want to call it, media, there's something about the one take it's a culmination mm-hmm. of the combination. It really is. It's the culmination of all the arts coming together mm-hmm. for a live presentation, like a theatrical presentation, but recorded in such a way where the camera becomes a character in itself. Mm-hmm. And it's your journey through this film. And like, I was right with you. After the first 30 minutes, I was like, hey, that was not bad. You know, the credits started rolling. I was like, cool. You know, I enjoyed that. That was worth seeing it, but I don't know if it was that great, Cecil.
Yeah.
And then there's like a whole other hour of the film. So, you know, there's like this beautiful aspect to anybody who likes to know a little bit about how horror films are made and, mm-hmm. and where the genesis of an original zombie idea can come from. Mm-hmm. And to the live TV aspect, I love the idea. Actually, to me, I felt this whole like, the studios were like, hey, you want to do this? And he's like, no, I really don't want to do that. And they're like, we'll pay you some money. And he's like, I really, and the wife is like, yeah, you better fucking do it. Mm-hmm. You know, like, so.
He doesn't turn anybody down.
And one of the things that I know that Cecil mentioned to me that he enjoyed was watching my reaction, because mm-hmm. throughout the film, there's all these moments during the first 30 minutes. So let's talk about the,
We'll get into the story. So you liked it.
Yeah,
The overall thoughts, you liked it.
I definitely thought it was very original and a really good, I wouldn't even call it a zombie movie. I wouldn't even call it a horror movie.
It's a comedy.
Yeah.
It's not a horror movie. It's a fantastic film movie.
It's a comedy set in the backdrop of a horror movie.
It's a film movie.
Well, it is. It's all movie. Of those things.
Yeah.
So they liked it a lot, obviously.
I loved it.
So the story, we can finally get into the story here. I did touch on it briefly in the earlier videos, but just to catch everyone up, this movie starts off as a zombie movie one take. Like, it's about a film crew making a zombie movie at this location when actual zombies show up and start taking out the crew. That's the premise of the film, right? And so this carries out in one take for the first 37 minutes of the movie. And then at 37 minutes, the credits roll. And you're like, wait, what?
Yeah, there was a woman next to me who was ready to get up.
She was gathering her stuff and everything.
I was like, that wasn't bad.
That's the thing, because I told Dave, I leaned over, I was like, remember, it's one shot. And so he watched it just, and the thing is, in that first 37 minutes, there are flaws, right? Because yeah. It's done. Very obvious glaring flaws. It's done as a one take, but there are obvious glaring flaws where there's weird pauses taken, weird dialogue.
Hey, there's, Jaime, what are your hobbies?
Repeat.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
I'm just gonna bring that.
Yeah, yeah, not only that, but there's a shot that's held obscenely long on one character for while they scream for an unknown reason.
Well, and honestly, we'll get into that.
Yeah.
The story.
So that's what happens in the first 37 minutes. That's what you get.
Yeah.
And then the credits roll, and then this, again, the reason I skirted around this issue when I first talked about the movie is I felt like, to some, the rest of the movie might be considered a bit of a spoiler.
Well, you don't have to talk too much about it. You can just say that there is more to the film. The behind-the-scenes aspect to
I think it's necessary to talk about, to be honest with you. So this all happens, and then also it is
subtitled film.
It is. It's so a foreign film.
A lot of people might miss stuff on just a single
watch. Well, I don't know. I got it on a single watch. You guys got it on a single watch. But nonetheless, what happens is after that credits roll, it goes to 2 months earlier, I think is what it says. So it flashes back and it shows one of the characters, the guy that played the director, get approached by two corporate people saying, hey, we have an idea.
And she's great.
And he's making commercials. He's making cheesy commercials.
Like a movie.
And there's two corporate shills that show up and say, hey, we have an idea. We want to do a 30-minute live movie.
Zombie.
That is a zombie movie.
Yeah.
All done in one take. And the guy at first is like, he laughs like, ha 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 ha.
Yeah, he's like,
that's
not just
crazy.
Live.
Yeah.
Not just live, not just one take, but both together.
Yeah. And zombies. Like, yeah. And he's like, that's crazy. And they're like, oh no, we're serious. Yeah. And they're like, do you want to do it? And so he takes on the project, and then the back half of the movie is the assemblage of the characters, and then the table read takes place for a little bit in the preparation for the film, and then the final act is how they actually pull off the first act of the movie, which is the brilliance of the film in seeing it as a big complete picture. It sounds a little bit weird, and it sounds,
take what would normally be the third act and put it at the very beginning. And then tell a story about a film crew coming together to make this, crazy, like literally crazy idea. Like just, we're going to do it 30 minutes live, no cuts.
It's
like,
not just live.
And the thing is, things don't go perfectly.
Yeah.
Things don't go perfectly.
No, right off. Well, I'm not going
to
ruin stuff.
Things don't go perfectly.
And that's what starts to add
the humor and explain things and all of this. It's just, honestly, and here's the way I put it when I watched it. I was like, the first part, I was like, yeah, the first act is okay. But the second and third act make the whole thing utterly brilliant.
Right.
Fall in love with these characters.
It absolutely, like, if you watch through to the end, it's just such a fulfilling experience. And the acting is great. So that's the story. You guys get the story now, and you guys appreciated how the story went, obviously.
Oh, I loved it. Their creative plight, the fact that they had to do so many things off the cuff, the fact that they had to improvise in the manner in which that they did, it just added so much genuine charm to the proceedings. And you're just like, man, that's what smart people do. They just think off the top of their heads and they just roll with that chisel, man.
Well, not only that, but pre-production aspects that David can speak to, where there's unpredictable aspects of film where actors can just disappear and you have to make do with what's available and things like that. So, your thoughts on the story, Dave?
Casting changes.
I think the story, again, is just the basic story of someone who's given a job that's really challenging and finds a way to accomplish that job.
Wasn't his mantra funny? He was
whether it's climbing Mount Everest or whatever, like, it's a very similar sort of structure of the thing. And I just thought that the brilliance of this whole thing was the reverse story order. The sort of like, for example, like one of my favorite movies of all time is Bowfinger.
Mm. And, oh, this is this.
And Bowfinger mm-hmm. builds to the crappy movie at the end, mm-hmm. whereas this one starts with the crappy movie at the beginning, mm-hmm. and you're like, okay, that was okay, but then you see the behind the scenes, and it's just nonstop laughs. It's nonstop laughs.
Not only that, but by the end, by the end, you literally want to stand up and cheer yeah. for what you've just seen yeah. because you're like, wow.
And all because they show mm-hmm. a little bit. Of the behind the scenes of how they actually made
of the actual one yeah. shot
the one and it was incredible
post-credits. Yeah I gotta hand was it nuts right.
I don't know if does this sound racist to say that the Japanese have something with choreography that I there's
no.
something in film that they can do with choreography that
the
I,
fight
I,
choreography alone that they have to do
right.
compared to us.
Well
yeah.
anyway the point being that there's certain aspects that you may not find funny as a just a casual couch watcher of horror films, but to see the actual frantic
yeah.
yeah crazy pace that they have to like live this 30 minutes, it's almost like a horror movie in itself. Mm-hmm. Like the crew mm-hmm. experiences this horror movie mm-hmm. of like the actors going off script and like mm-hmm. people improvising and people having to poop and like all this crazy shit that just happens.
Yeah,
and
right.
You can't like find one single thing that's wrong with the film
right.
in the
right.
end, because the flaws are part of it.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's really what the brilliance of it is all about.
Yeah. Finding yourself in that sort of creative scenario sounds so scary to me. Like, genuinely, it's just like, my God, nerves yeah. of steel.
Listen, don't think it hasn't crossed my mind to have us do a live sketch.
I mean, mm-hmm. I don't want to spoil it, but I want you guys to be able to react to what I'm about, the
okay.
moment in the film that you guys will love so much is the whole, once we get past the film part, the really the first part that we're diving into, how that first part was made, is like one of the best parts of the film, because the director the director just goes crazy.
Mm-hmm.
and that's what's so fun about the rest of the film is mm-hmm. like, oh, subverted my expectations with the beginning 35 minutes and now we're going to go into an actual film.
But there is still, and let's not discount the fact that even though the first 30 minutes are like, you're like, okay, that's good, there are still some really genuinely gold moments.
Yeah.
Let me just say one word. Action! And like, that brings on laughs in that first 30 minutes, big
also,
time.
Palmer
don't
Power
need to speak,
or whatever it was,
it doesn't have to be in English.
Yeah.
It doesn't
yeah.
have to be in English to yeah. be hilarious.
There's so much funny. But again, it does qualify. I think it absolutely is worthy of being covered on our channel, because it's all about the making
yeah.
of a horror film.
Yeah. Right.
And there's gore galore.
Right, it is a horror.
You know what I mean?
It is a horror film.
Yeah, you don't have
yeah.
to give any explanation about covering this one. This is definitely
well, because he was saying it's kind of not
one.
Quite even horror.
I, in my opinion,
yeah,
it's
no,
a
if,
film
and you're not
movie.
Wrong. You're not
right.
wrong.
Yeah.
You're not wrong.
Whatever.
It almost feels documentary-esque, like mockumentary-esque.
Mockumentary-esque,
yeah.
yes.
Yes. Mockumentary
a little bit.
For sure, yeah. It's got some of the Spinal
without
Tap
the whole,
DNA in there.
Without the whole, like, confessional...
But let's talk about the acting, though, because, I mean, the acting was stellar in so much of this. From the director to his wife to
his daughter
to the actor that she was obsessed with.
Yeah.
And to the actress who's like, oh, there's vomit here. I can't do vomit. You know, it's not
no,
me.
She's like,
it's
yeah,
my agency.
It's my agency.
Yeah.
That's great.
Then,
that's great.
Like,
again,
that's why I know that's
again.
Why you loved it so much, because I know you dealt
again,
with almost
the,
every
they,
one of the shit that they dealt with in this.
This is the cleverness. This is the cleverness and smartness of the script, is that they pay off every moment
mm-hmm.
of the first 37 minutes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you sit through the first 37 minutes. Don't forget anything, because they fucking come back to all of it.
Yeah.
And they fucking, they explain hilarity in every moment of that first 37 minutes. And that's
mm-hmm.
what's like I said, it's just brilliant. It's really great. It reminds me of how I felt when I watched Memento. Where I was like, oh shit, they changed the structure. They changed mm-hmm. the whole vibe of how a film is presented to people. And then,
this one, that does it right away, and you notice right away. This one takes 37 minutes before you realize that something odd is going on.
Right, but...
Like, I'm worried about people, like, not sticking through that first 37 minutes.
But staying with that first 37...
If you stick past the credits rolling, then you're gonna have a, an experience of your life.
If you sit in a film for more than 5 minutes, you're invested.
Okay.
You've bought into the premise, you've bought into the story, and maybe there's something that turns you off that makes you leave. Okay. But in the most part, that first 30 minutes, you can't look away because it's a one cut.
Yeah.
And that's just me again. As I don't know if everybody's like that, like you start watching this and they're like, it feels so real. I think that's what it is. It's so visceral and like, you know, even as a filmmaker, you know, it's real because there's no cuts. Even if there's a clever cut, mm-hmm. which I didn't even see.
Mm-mm.
I didn't see a clever cut. And I was like, there were so many moments where they could have done a clever, like freeze cut, you know, transition morph or whatever you want to call it.
And those first 30 minutes, though, are the building blocks for the hilarious payoff that you get in the back half of the film. And, I mean, if you weren't paying proper attention, I think that's what adds the element of rewatchability to this movie. Didn't you tell me when you were watching it for the second time, you're like, oh,
I was watching the original film. And when things were happening in the first 37 minutes, like, there's at one point three people are talking and like having a fun time together, and suddenly there's a loud noise and they all stop and look over, and like I'm the only one that busts out laughing because I know that later in the movie, like, I even looked at Fuego, I was like, I'm laughing because I know why that's funny and you don't yet.
Time out.
And like that's,
and I'm like scratching my head.
Can I do the Zach Morris time out?
Time out, sure.
Tell the little story. Have you told the little story about how you got it and how you saw it before it was
Did in the last video, but just in case you guys didn't know, the reason I've been able to see this twice now is the person that actually got us connected with this event, Monty from the International Horror and Sci-Fi Film Festival, the festival director.
Indeed.
He's the one that posted back in November on Facebook saying, guys, this is one of the best movies I saw this year. One Cut of the Dead is available on Amazon Prime. Go watch it now. And I just so happened, it happened to be the last week that we were compiling our best of 2018 lists.
There was even a blood
And so he posted about it. I'm like, wow, best of 2018. I'm like, I'm making that list. Let me try it. And so I watched it and I enjoyed the hell out of it.
It's good.
Even though there was racist subtitles at the time. That's the thing. Like, that's whenever the female
I want to watch the racist subtitles.
Whenever the female corporate person talked, anytime she had a word that was like really, really, it would go reary, reary. And it would spell it with two R's, two capital R's instead of two L's.
That's not even funny.
No, but that's what the person did. So that is part of why that movie was only on Amazon Prime for one day, 24 hours, and then Amazon pulled it down because it was a bootleg version. Because
I went to watch it
the very next day. I was like, you guys got to watch this, and it was not available. So they didn't get to watch it.
So you
I
saw
put
the hacked
list.
Version.
I saw the hacked version
on
but it
Amazon
was,
Prime.
But it was, but it was just, the only thing that was different was the subtitles.
Right. And yet the thing we discussed, we're like, how does a hacked version end up on Prime? Like,
and that was the big news article
for a couple of minutes. So we could bring it to all 26,184 of you.
Exactly. So that's how I got to see it twice. So that's why when I was watching it the second time, I knew all of the reasons for all of the mess ups in the first 37 minutes, because there's some awkward pauses and some awkward lingering shots that you're just like, okay, this there has to be a reason for it, but I don't know. And in the background, all you hear is pump, pump, pump. But when you get to the last act and it explains why, you're just like, you're smiling from ear to ear the whole last act. As everything plays out and you
reliving
see the reasons
it,
for everything.
I like legit felt like, dude, at the end of Breakfast Club, just like, oh, I'm so stoked for them, man.
Yeah, it was so good. So, okay, the effects. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about the effects. Now, obviously, there was some cheats and stuff as far as the first actual presentation of the one cut and what they had to show you towards the end. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, presentation-wise...
I would say this about the effects. I wouldn't expect great, great gore. Like, this isn't a gory film. This is sort
of... The parts that are gory are pretty gory.
Well,
the dude that had the biggest job in the whole movie was the dude that had the hose.
That was a girl.
It was a girl.
Oh,
but also...
Sorry.
But also, like, you know, the guy with the arm, you know...
Well, like, and also bringing in for the decapitation scene on the rooftop.
Look, it's not serious gore.
Right.
So that's the difference. It's not Saw gore. It's
It's not even
gore.
Tucker and Dale gore, it's where it's fun silly gore trying to be
right.
real gore.
It's just fun. It's just it's silly makeup. Gore. Yeah. And that's the best part, I think. One of the best parts. I mean, I love gore as much as the next guy, like, properly done. But if it's not going to be a gore fest, if it's not going to be, like, really good zombies, then they did it perfectly.
Then make
like
it
they
campy,
did it
perfectly. Make it fun.
Yes,
it's not going to be high quality. I mean,
it's campy. It's hilarious through the whole fucking thing, especially the back half.
Mm-hmm.
And you can really appreciate that first one take. Okay. You really can, because that's
especially
not
if
easy.
Any of you have tried
it
to make a film or short films or any association with filmmaking, you will appreciate this movie.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And from production assistant to goddamn director.
Except editors.
And anyone in between.
Editors won't like this
having
movie.
Been on
no
a
way. Editors will appreciate how it's put together. Are you right. kidding? Come on.
Having been on a set with both of you guys where we had to change a cast member in the middle of
literally. Oh my God. We literally did that. I didn't even keep that in mind. Yeah. We filmed a whole day on suite with a guy that's not in suite.
Yeah.
Damn! Did we ever tell that story? I don't know that
we
did. We
did.
Holy crap!
We might have.
We need to tell that on a podcast or something.
I think that was in the making of. Maybe we.
No, we didn't.
No, because
when
we talked to Ryan
briefly.
Well, when we talked to Ryan, he spoke about.
Still, there's a whole story there. There's a whole story there, but.
No, that was what I immediately thought of. I'm like, well, in the 11th hour, sometimes you just gotta wing it, man.
So I mean, we covered acting, we covered effects. I mean, cinematography and stuff. It's
well, that's the creme de la creme.
Yeah, I mean, the one shot is
brilliant. You gotta fucking hand it to the guy who held the camera.
Tip your cap to the pre-production.
I would say
planning.
I would say like 97% perfect, which is like, you know, hitting it out of the park.
The planning involved in this must have been insane.
The aspect of going live is one thing, but the aspect of doing something live and one take just.
That was the supposition that they weren't actually
doing it live.
Oh, obviously.
I know, but like the idea that they were doing it live that they couldn't cut away, or if they did, it would be like
to make or break the
movie, graphic.
Yeah.
So there is a point where they're like, okay, get ready to cut away to the fucking because this is fucked. Mm-hmm. You know, like get ready to cut away.
The daughter steps in. No,
and
we can fix this.
Just to harken back, I don't think I talked much about the acting because I wanted
to
just
touch on it.
We'll just loop back, and this will be our kind of like sum up.
Sure.
I think why I fell in love with this movie is because of the actors. The even not like having to read their dialogue and having them campy and overact and be silly, to me it felt okay. Like it was okay.
Everything about this film was
done within the margins of acceptability, and like it just makes sense and it's funny and it's great, and the characters, especially the daughter, who shows up as like this wild card tornado and like just makes the movie in her
She's
own
introduced
way.
Introduced by telling a kid that he's not invested enough in his commercial role. Like you can tell.
And
how
she gets fired for
yeah.
it. Yeah,
it's amazing.
She's
great character.
And like I said, the acting is what it needs to be.
Absolutely.
Whether or not it's good, it's like it's perfect.
Everyone plays
perfect.
Their role, yeah.
It's perfect for what it needs to be.
Especially the drunk crew member. Oh, wow. So good.
They're all great. Well, I mean, honestly, I have to piggyback on, you know, the daughter to the mother and the fact that you can tell that Apple didn't fall far from the tree. The fact that she stopped acting because she got so meta
into the role
and stuff and improvising and just going back.
That's actually why she stopped acting. She broke another actor's arm.
Well,
and
then
she almost,
like,
breaks the guy's arm.
She almost kills the actress.
Well, and that's what's, to me, in my head, then I started thinking about to the moment when she's axing the other guy and I'm like, oh shit, did she actually fucking kill the guy? And I'm like, oh, this is going to be really good.
Yeah.
Like,
and then when she stands up, too.
Which totally stuck out like a sore thumb when I was watching
the
first
like,
30 minutes.
I was
like,
what
just happened?
It's beautiful. I told you, they pay off every moment of the 37 minutes where you're like,
do you see why this made my top 10 of 2018?
Well, this
was just utterly brilliant.
This made it into my top 10 films of all time.
Easily top 5 zombie movies. Mm-hmm. Easily top 5 zombie movies.
If you haven't seen Living in Oblivion, it's a very similar sort of like cerebral, sort of like crazy, everything goes wrong film about filmmaking.
Okay.
And so like, you know, the main actor, he's like, well, I want to wear an eye patch. And the director's like, I'm going to kill myself. And like, you know, other people, like there's a cell phone ringing. And then it turns out it's a dream. So there's this, you know, there's subtle things that I look for in a film movie, mm-hmm. like Bowfinger or Living in Oblivion, that I think this film, if you have a love of movies in general and how movies are made, you'll love this movie. But also, if you love horror movies, you'll get that extra little side behind the scenes aspect of the craziness that's required to try and pull off a one shot mm-hmm. for 37 minutes.
Mm-hmm. Well, the American remake of this is already in the planning process, and I have very mixed feelings about that.
I really do. Yeah, I mean, I think, well, here's what I'll say. Let the Right Ones In was one of those films that I saw as a foreign film that was like,
the Let Me In remake was still pretty good.
And the remake was okay.
Yeah.
Same with Girl with the Pearl Earring. What the fuck was
Girl
that?
With the Dragon Tattoo?
Dragon Tattoo. Yeah, the one David Same Fincher with the did. Dragon Tattoo. Yeah. Because they got Fincher to do the fucking American version, I was like, okay, you know, and it was all right. But the fucking foreign version was way better. Mm-hmm. Way better because, mm-hmm. you know. So, we'll see about the
remake.
The American version.
For now, this is worth seeking out. Guys, I spent $35 on a copy of this that came directly from Hong Kong. Granted, that's not Japan. That's Hong Kong, China, that I got my copy of this Japanese zombie movie. But I'm glad to own it because you see why I'd want to revisit this.
Well, and if you enjoyed this review, we'll watch the special features.
So Do you guys want us to watch the special features and review those as well? And maybe I can show some clips of them and stuff like that. Sure. I can do that. So
down like a clown.
Let us know if you'd have an interest in that. And let us know if you finally get... It's coming to Shudder, you said.
It is coming to Shudder. They don't have a specific release date yet, but it was announced recently that, it's going to be on that streaming service. So
you guys are going to get your chance to watch it. And I tell you right now, if this movie drops on Shudder and you haven't paid the $5 to get Shudder, this movie is worth getting 1 month of Shudder for. You'll probably get a free month anyway, but even if you're paying the $5 for 1 month just to watch this movie, let alone the fact that you can watch the Wolf Creek series or the Channel Zero series or any number of other awesome Joe Bob Briggs, Shudder is just worth it no matter what, guys.
It's a donation to the horror community as a whole.
Indeed. But nonetheless, this movie is worth your $5. If none of the other stuff interests you, spend the $5 once this drops on Shudder. Or buy it for $35 from Hong Kong on Amazon like I did.
We're not sponsored by Shudder, by the way.
No, we're not. Although,
in fact,
I'd happily do it.
You're even going to put an Amazon link in the description.
Indeed, I will do that.
To the movie. So that you'll make a buck every time someone buys it.
Nope, that's what a good showrunner would do.
Yeah.
Produce Dave, and I'm up.
All right, thank you guys very much for watching. If you enjoyed this, put down in the comments what you enjoyed about it, or if you have an interest in this movie, let us know. While you're down there, click the like button if you enjoyed the video, and subscribe if you want to see more stuff like this. We've got a bunch of other reviews coming from the International Horror and Sci-Fi Film Festival, and we also recently just reviewed the brand new The Curse of La Llorona. So check
La
that
La
out.
La
Llorona. La Llorona, as Marsha said. That our Coexist shirt is available in the link in the description box to
Somebody buy
site.
The shirt, for fuck's sake.
Please, really. I mean, it's our own Coexist design, but
we love you
guys very much for watching. This was a loose review, but we had some fun.
Yes, we did.
Go watch One Cut of the Dead as soon as you can.
You will be
until
genuinely happy.
Next time, I've been Cecil Laird.
Gracias, I've been Jaime Fuego.
And I've approved this message, Producer Dave.
And remember, stay scared!